still don't roll nowhere. It could be parked on a hill without the wheels being chalked and it won't move. Why? What's holding that trailer from rolling? The spring brake system. So the spring brake system gonna automatically work irregardless. It's automatic. Air, what air does, it goes into the system and retracts the spring so that the brakes can release, so the pad lining can release off the drum and cause that drum to have rotation. So air allows you to move. Your air tank's got to have anywhere from 120 to 140 PSI. You can't have a specific number because each manufacturer is different. Freightliner is different from Volvo. Volvo is different from Peterbilt. Peterbilt different from International, and so on and so forth, right? But irregardless of who that manufacturer is, it has to shut off anywhere between 120 to 140 PSI. That is the normal operating levels for a truck to operate down the road. You need to be at your air tanks need to be holding 120 to 140 pounds of pressure of air in those tanks. All right. So if you look at the screen here, you see you got air compressor governor, and air storage tanks. Everybody on here know what an air compressor is. It pumps air. Hell, you run out of air in your tire and you go to a gas station, that machine that you hear pump motor running, that's an air compressor that's pumping that air into your tire. So this air compressor, you got one on your engine in your truck and buses. The air compressor is built into your engine. So when your truck is on and the engine is running, the air compressor is on. All right. This governor, though, tells this air compressor when to turn on and when to turn off, when to stop pumping air, when to stop pumping air. That's what the governor does. He governs when the air compressor should come on and off. The air compressor is pumping air into your storage tanks. You have two storage tanks under your truck. You have a primary tank and you have a secondary tank, and they both have their own gauges on your dash so you can know how much air pressure you got in each tank. All right, each tank, you need to know how much pressure in each tank, your primary tank and your secondary tank. All right, so when your air pressure compressor pumps air and your tanks get anywhere between 120 to 140 PSI, this air governor should tell this air compressor enough. That's enough air, cut off. And that air compressor should stop pumping air into those tanks. But say this air compressor for some reason breaks. It goes bad on you, and the air compressor doesn't cut off, and it just keeps pumping air into your tanks. Your tanks can explode, and you have scrap metal going everywhere. So to prevent that, your air compressor tank or your air tanks under your truck has this thing here, what we call the safety valve. A safety valve. You see right here, the valve is usually set to open at 150 PSI. Remember, I said normal operating is anywhere from 120 to 140. So once you pass 140 and keep pumping air, once you start getting close to 150 PSI, this safety valve is going to release some of that air pressure out of your tanks. I don't know if you've ever been around a commercial truck or bus and you hear it make that psh sound. That's this safety valve releasing air out of those tanks. All right. So it's there as a safety mechanism to protect the truck from the air tanks exploding because too much air pressure building in it. All right. Because that air compressor ain't going to stop. It's going to keep pumping if that governor breaks. All right. So you got to have a secondary backup just in case to relieve that pressure. And that's what this safety valve is going to open at 150 PSI. All right. Those machine, because that air compressor is pumping air into those tanks, those air tanks can start building condensation. And you can start building moisture inside of your tanks, and that water can start building up. All right, so the federal government said we need to drain our tanks at the end of every workday. So at the end of every workday, we need to drain our tanks. All right. If the reason they want us to drain our tanks is if you let moisture build up in your tanks, and say you travel up north in the cold weather, right now it's starting to get cold across the United States, especially in the northern regions. All right, you start traveling up there and the temperature drops below 30 degrees Celsius, what's going to happen is that water is going to freeze in your tanks. And so remember I said air allows your wheels to turn. You need air so the wheels can turn. Well, imagine if ice get in your lines and block the air from getting to your brakes. What's going to happen? It's going to make your spring brakes automatically deploy, and it's going to lock all 18 of your wheels at the same time while you're driving down the road at 65, 75, 85 miles an hour, depending on what state you're in, because speed limits are different state by state. And I don't got to tell nobody on this Zoom class that if you lock all 18 of your wheels at 50 at that rate of speed at the same time, ain't nothing good gonna happen. The results are going to be catastrophic. It may end up in death, and not only death of you, but the death of other people out there too, because that trailer's going to jackknife. Anybody understand that?
Yes,
Now,
sir.
that's why the federal government takes this air brake thing very serious, and they want to make sure you, as a driver, understand how it's was working, how it's working, and what to look for so you can be safety, right? So, if you look here, we talked about the safety valve. If you look right here where it says
You
SCAP.
said drain. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, but I got a question. You said about the drain out a tank. What tank was that again? The water tank.
We ain't never said nothing about no water tank. So are you listening to me? We talking about
Sorry,
air. He's
air
a
tank.
water tank. But water can build up in your tank. That maybe that's what you're talking about when I said water.
Yes,
Yeah, so
yes.
that air compressor is a machine, and the machine is pumping water inside those tanks. And that water, that air in that machine can cause your tanks to start building condensation, moisture, and it start dripping inside of your truck. And the risk it runs is it can freeze up and block your airlines where your air can't get to your brakes, which will cause your brakes to come on and lock your brakes. So now you're stuck somewhere in the winter in the cold and you can't move because your brakes are froze. Right,
Makes
so we have
sense.
to. So the federal government and highway patrol said we must drain our air tanks at the end of every workday. And right here, if you look at this little tank, you got a manual drain or you got an automatic. So some tanks you got to pull yourself and do it, and some automatically do it. Irregardless to which kind you have, automatic or manual, the thing about it is it needs to be done at the end of every workday, making sure you don't have moisture build up inside of your tanks. All right, did I answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, no problem. All right, S-CAM. So this is the type of brake system that you have on your trucks and your buses that operates this system. So I'm gonna read this paragraph because it's going to tell you briefly what's going on inside that drum that you don't see. So when you push the brake pedal, air is let into the air brake chamber. Air pressure pushes the rod out, moving the slack adjuster, thus twisting the brake camshaft. This turns the S-cam. It's called S-cam because it's shaped like the letter S. The S-cam forces the brake shoes away from one another and presses them against the inside of the brake drum. Excuse me. And when you release the brake pedal, the S-cam rotates back and the spring pulls the brake shoes away from the drum, letting the wheels roll freely again. So I'm gonna give you a picture of that diagram what I just read so you can get a visual kind of what I'm talking about. So you look at this diagram, this is a picture of a brake drum. This spring right here is the spring I was telling you about. This spring is so powerful, it's pushing this pad lining against this drum so that wheel cannot turn. All right. There's so much pressure in this spring that it can hold an 80,000-pound truck and trailer parked on an incline on a decline, and it will not move. But that's how much pressure that spring is pushing this pad against that drum. So when you let air into there, air turns this S-cam right here, it's shaped like the letter S, that's why they call it S-cam, thus pulls the push rod and slack adjuster, which causes the spring to retract. Once the spring retracts, it releases the pressure of this pad off the drum. So now this drum can have rotation, it can turn. All right, so that's what air is doing, it's pushing, it's retracting the spring so these wheels can turn. The less pressure you have, the more the brakes are going to start to apply. You don't have enough air, then the spring is going to kick in fully 100% and lock this wheel where it won't turn. Everybody got that?
Yes, is there a
Yes.
name for that spring, or is it just
It's
called a spring?
just called the spring brake system. That's what you
Okay.
need to know for your test. It's called a spring brake system. They're going to ask you what is a spring brake system? It's a brake system held on by mechanical force. That's the answer. A spring brake system is a brake system held on by mechanical force. The reason I'm saying that twice, because that's one of the questions on your permit test. They're going to ask you what a spring brake system is. And the answer is this brake system held on by mechanical force. All right. So if you look at the top there, you see me keep checking this update because I don't want to cut off on us. Supply pressure gauges. All right, your supply pressure gauge is a gauge that's on your dash on inside your truck. Just like how you have a fuel gauge in your car and it tell you how much fuel you got in your tanks. That's what this supply pressure gauge. It looks like a fuel gauge, but you got two of them. And they tell you how much air you got in each tank. Each tank has its own gauge. And it tells you, each gauge tells you how much pressure is in each tank. Remember, we said we need to be at 120 to 140 PSI. How do you know? You look at your supply pressure gauge. That supply pressure gauge will tell you. Then you see application pressure gauge, this right here. That's just another gauge that's on your dash. That gauge, I never used it in my life, to tell you the truth, but it's there. It just tells you how much pounds of pressure you're applying to the service brake when you smash it. And that's all. Why you need to know that, I don't know. But some people, I guess, technologically like to know everything. As long as I have that sucker stop when I smash the brake, that's all I'm concerned about. And how much air pressure I got in my tanks, then that's what I'm watching. Nevertheless, it's on the test, so I need to tell you about it. Application pressure gauge. All right, low air warning pressure. So remember I said you need to be 120 to 140 PSI for normal operation of that truck safely down the highways and the streets, public roadways. Well, say you're driving down the street and you run over something and cut your airline under your truck or your trailer and you didn't know it. So you're just driving on down the road, but you got an air leak and you don't know it. You can't hear it. Well, your supply pressure gauge is going to start dropping. All right. So once it's dropped between the ranges of 75, if you look here, 75 and 55 PSI, an alarm has to come on in your truck, and it is a law. No truck or bus company can sell you a truck or bus with an air brake system on it if it don't have an alarm system on it. That is the law. It has to have some type of warning device. All right. So, matter of fact, when you go to the DMV the second time to do your pre-trip skills and road, they're gonna have to do an air brake test on you. That examiner gonna sit in that passenger seat, and you gotta pump your brake and bleed the air out of your brakes to get it between 55 and 75. And that examiner literally wants to hear that alarm go off in your truck to know it works. That's how serious it is with them. They take it that serious. So that alarm is set to come on at 55 and 75 PSI. And I advise you, when you hear that alarm come on, you better be looking for somewhere to pull over ASAP, the shoulder. So you need to get off the road as soon as possible. Because if you ignore it and say, well, it's a truck stop down the street, I'm going to wait till I get down there. If that leaks bad enough and that pressure keeps dropping, once it drops between the ranges of 20 and 45, 20 and 45 PSI, your spring brake's going to automatically kick in. Ain't nothing you can do about it. You ain't no way you can stop it. All your brakes are going to lock all 18 of your wheels at the same time while you're driving down the road. And
What
again,
PSI was that?
between 20 and 45 PSI, 20 and
20.
45 PSI, and the
Okay.
alarm is set to come on between 75 and 55 PSI. All
Okay.
right, everybody got that? Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Spring brakes, right here. All trucks and truck and tractors and buses must be equipped with emergency brakes and parking brakes. Now, again, emergency brake and a parking brake is the same. Don't think that there are two different switches in your truck that you one operates the other one. Nope, the same brake you pull to park your truck when you're done driving for the day is the same one you pull for your emergency brakes. Your emergency brake and your parking brake are the same in a commercial truck. They're exactly the same. And they must be held on by mechanical force because air compress can air pressure can eventually leak away. All right. So that's why they don't use air for your brakes. Because say you park your truck and your brakes is controlled by air. And then you go into a building, then you come back out and you had a leak on your brakes and you didn't know it, and all the air pressure leaked away. And now your brakes done released. Now you come outside and your truck gone because it done rolled down the hill because the brakes released on it. All right, so that's why they didn't trust that. So they said we can't use air for the brakes. That's why your brakes are a spring brake system. It's a brake system held on by mechanical force. We just read right here. They are must be held on by mechanical force. All right. Let us move on. Dual braking. So dual brakes is just talking about the same thing. You got two tanks under your truck and your trailer, same thing. But we're going to talk more about the trailer tomorrow. Tomorrow, when we deal with combinations, we'll deal more about that. All right. So once you get inside your truck on your dashboard, you also have these two knobs. Pay attention to the bottom two. You barely see these top one anymore. These ones y'all gonna see on the regular, on newer trucks. This is what you're gonna see. This octagon shape one is gonna be red, and this diamond shape one is gonna be yellow. I don't care what truck you get in. I don't care who made it, Freightliner, Volvo. The colors are the same. The octagon red one looks like a stop sign, and the yellow diamond one. Well, the
And
red one
Kenneth.
supplies air to your trailer. This is the one you press when you want to release the brakes on your trailer. The diamond shaped yellow one, it supplies air to your tractor, the truck you're driving. So this is the one you push in when you want the brakes to release. So you push it in to release the brakes so you can drive. You pull it out when you want to cut the air pressure off and make the spring brakes come on because you're about to park the truck. All right, so in to go, out to stop. All right, and the red octagon is the trailer brake. The diamond yellow one is the tractor brake. Everybody understand that?
Yes.
All right. Why must air tanks be drained? Anybody remember?
So they don't, what's it called? So they don't lock up when it's cold out.
So they won't freeze up and lock your brakes. So they won't freeze up and lock your brakes. Number two, what is a supply pressure gauge used for?
Hey, how much air you have in your tanks?
Yes, it tells you how much air pressure you have in your tanks. Three, all vehicles with air brakes must have a low air pressure warning signal in them. Is that true or false?
True.
That is
True.
true. That is correct. Number four, what are spring brakes?
A brake system held by mechanical force.
That is correct. A brake system held on by mechanical force. Number five, front wheel brakes are good under all conditions. The key word there is all conditions. Is that true or false?
False.
Yes, that is
False.
false. Because sometimes front end brakes can cause front end skids. So that is false. That is correct. Number six, how do you know if your vehicle is equipped with anti-lock brakes?
Indicator light.
Yes. Remember that from yesterday, huh? All right, good job.
Was number six?
I don't remember what number six was. I'm going now. What?
Was
How do you know if your we talked about that yesterday? ABS light would come on your dashboard,
oh,
remember?
sorry, AB.
Yeah. So if you got an ABS system on there, once you turn the ignition on, you should get an ABS light, should flash on your dashboard. All right. One-way check valve. One-way check valve. What you need to know about that is what is it for and where is it located? What is it for? Where is it located? Where it's located on your engine between the air compressor and the first reservoir. That's the location between the air compressor and the first reservoir. Well, what is it there for? It's there to keep air from going out if the air compressor develops a leak. So if your air compressor ever break bad on you, all right, that one-way check valve will reserve the air that it already done pumped into your reservoirs. It'll protect the air in your reservoirs, which will give you enough air pressure to get your truck to safety. All right, so that's what it's there for. One-way check valve, it protects the air in your reservoir if the air compressor ever develops a leak or breaks bad.
What's it called? Progress what?
Huh?
Compress what?
Air compressor?
Yes, thank you. Sorry.
I didn't. I'm trying to figure out what you're saying. Like, you said
Sorry.
compress something. I'm like, huh? Compress? Air compressor, yeah. If the air compressor stopped working, that one-way check valve to protect the air in the reservoir. That's what it's for.
You still have
All right.
brakes. Okay.
Huh? All right, this here, you see me passing up. You don't have to know this for your permit test, but you are going to have to know it the second time you go to the DMV to test because you got to do an air brake test for that examiner, like I was telling you before. When you pump on the brakes, and the alarm has to come on. You got to pop them to the spring brakes. You got to show them where the governor cuts out at. So you have to perform an air brake test, and we're going to show you how to do that once you come to the yard. So you don't need to know this for your permit. So that's why I'm passing this up. All right. Remember yesterday we talked about two type of braking. Anybody remember those two? They right here.
Control and stab braking.
Stab braking. Which one do we do?
Control braking.
Why we don't do stab braking?
We don't do ABS won't let it.
ABS won't allow us to do it. It's not that stab braking is a bad thing. It's just we can't do it because all our trucks after March 1st, 1997, all of them required to have ABS systems on it. So we can't do stab. Before that, we used to could do it. But after then, when the ABS got put in the trucks, we can't do it no more. All right, so we do control braking. All right. Remember brake fade and brake failing? Okay, so remember yesterday we talked about overheating your brakes would cause them to fail if you ride them going down the mountain, remember? All right, but there's another thing that can make your brakes fade and fail too. So you're going to see this on your permit test, and they're going to ask you what two things contribute to brake fade and brake failure, all right? And the answer is we know overheating is one because we talked about that yesterday, but the second one is right here. Brakes out of adjustment. Brakes out of adjustment. So when you see this on your permit test, the answer is overheating and out of adjustment causes trucks to have brake fade or failure. All right. And remember yesterday we talked about perception distance, reaction distance, and braking distance. Well, with air brakes, they add one more thing to this equation, and that's brake lag distance. Brake lag distance. And the key word in this is that word lag. That word lag means to procrastinate or to hesitate. So that means then that there is a hesitation in your air brake system. So which the how's that going to affect us? That's going to affect us because that means we got to get in on our brakes even earlier to slow this truck down because we know it's a brake lag there. It's going to be a little hesitation. You got to remember that air has to travel through your system, all through your brake lines, into the brake chamber, through the S-cam system. So it's a lot of traveling, a lot of work that air is doing. So it's going to be a little lag. So it's called brake lag distance. So we must compensate for that brake lag distance by getting on our brakes a little more earlier. You got to get, remember them trucks, we hauling heavy equipment down the road. Sometimes you do flatbed, you could be having anything back there. Farm equipment, all type of stuff, modular homes, I mean, all types of stuff. And that stuff is heavy. And you got to bring that, when you see a red light up ahead, you got to bring that big truck to a stop, right? So we need to get on that brake early because we're aware of brake lag distance, all right? Why should you be in the proper gear before starting down a hill? We talked about that yesterday.
Because you won't be able to shift in that gear while you're going down the hill. Your speed might be off from your engine RPMs and you won't be able to get it shifted into the proper gear. So you're supposed to start out in the gear before you go down the hill.
I mean, that's a good analogy, and that's true. What you're saying is not wrong, but that's not the answer they're looking for with this question. So they're saying, why should you be in a proper gear before starting down a hill? And the reason we downshift and be in a proper gear is because we want to control our speed going down the hill. That's what they want to hear. Everything you said is true, but the answer is to control your speed. To control your speed. Number two. What factors can cause brakes to fade and fail? We just talked about that.
Overheating and out of adjustment.
Exactly. Overheating and being out of adjustment. Number three, the use of brakes on a long, steep downgrade is only a supplement, the key word supplement, to the braking effect of the engine. Is that true or false?
True.
That is true. Your service brake should not be your primary brake. It should be the supplement, secondary. That low gear you downshifted to and your engine retarder or engine brake are your two primary brakes when you're going downhill. That's what should be slowing your truck down. You should smash the service brake with your foot every now and then because when you do that, you give your brakes chances to cool in between the times you have to smash it so they don't overheat. You're giving them chance to cool. If you stay on your brakes and never give them chance to cool, they're going to overheat and you're going to burn them out. And then you're going to have what we talked about earlier, brake fade and brake failure. All right.
Is that what they call a Jake brake?
Yes, a Jake brake is an engine brake. That's an old school name for it, the old Jake brake. All right. Number four, if you're away from your vehicle only a short time, you do not need to use your parking brake. True or false?
False.
Well, I'm finna say, if somebody say true, I'm finna say log out. It was nice meeting you.
Oh, yeah,
You get out of truck and don't put the brakes on if you want to and see what's gonna happen. Your trucking career gonna be over as soon as it started. All right. All right. How often should you drain your air tanks?
every work day.
At
After
the
every work day.
end of every work day. That is correct. At the end of every work day. Number six, how do you brake when you drive a tractor trailer combination with ABS?
Control braking. Normally,
Control.
whatever normal braking is, you keep doing it.
Control braking. Control braking is the answer. Control braking. How do you, oh, we just did that one, right? How do you brake when you tractor trailer combination? Okay, number seven. You still have normal brake function if your ABS is not working. That's true or false?
True.
That's true. That's right. Like I told y'all yesterday, I drove a truck all the way across country with the ABS light on the whole way. I still had normal brakes. All right. Good job. Y'all do be listening. That's it. Told you, air brakes is over. Air brakes is short. It ain't number 30 questions on your permit test. So any questions about air brakes?
No.
Can you go over to for that last quiz? You just told us what stands for number five. I was writing it down. I was able to finish it.
On what quiz?
The one you just the questions you asked us.
Okay, what about it? Which one are you missing? I mean,
Number
this ain't
five.
no number
Number
five
five.
was how often should you drain your air tanks?
Oh, that one. I know that one. At after the end of the work day.
Exactly. Right, any other questions? Remember, there's no such thing as a dumb question. You're here to learn.
You said what's when you say tomorrow we'll learn about combination.
That's your third test at the DMV, the combination test.